going to continue on where we left off. We're going to be talking about standing against the wiles of the devil. We're going to be talking about spiritual warfare. And in my viewpoint, to understand spiritual warfare, you have to understand how Satan attacks. If you don't know how he attacks, how can you fight against it? And so we already seen Satan's scheme, how he attacks, what he wants to do to your thinking process, and so on. So, again, where his attack is going to be at is at the mind. He wants to mess up your thinking process. The battle's for the mind. It really is. If he can get your mind, he can get your actions, your behavior, and so on. So, again, the battle is over our thinking process. Yes, we look at Ephesians chapter 6, 11. Put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. We already talked about that. His schemes. So we have to understand his schemes, which we already went through. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. So again, our enemy is not people, is it? Our enemy is in the spiritual realm. The evolutionists are not our enemy. Not at all. They're victims of a lie. So when I look at these people, I look at them as victims. Somebody has messed with their brain and their thinking process. So if you look at them as victims, you look at these people differently. Victims need what? To get saved. Yes. So our fight is against the spiritual realm, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world. We're going to talk about more about the God of this world and the prince of this world. Against spiritual wickedness in high places. Yes. So again, our fight is against the demonic realm. So it's a different type of fighting. Not that what you would do in the physical sense. Yes. Finally, my brother, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Where is our power at? Not in us. It's in Christ. Yes, strong in the Lord. That's where we need to be. And therefore standing, therefore having your loins girded with truth. So, according to Scripture, what is true? God and his word is truth. Yes, not man's wisdom. So if you follow man's wisdom, you've already been defeated. He's got you. The truth, God and his word are true. Yeah, and the breastplate of righteousness. So again, God and his word are true. The breastplate of righteousness. Jesus is our righteousness. Okay? We need to be walking in Christ. Also, Christ is our righteousness. Does that mean we live in sin? No. We're supposed to be conformed to the image of God, Jesus Christ. He's holy and righteous. So if we live in sin, hey, we've lost part of our armor. The breastplate of righteousness. Where is the breastplate put? Right here. What is right here? Our heart. Protect your heart from sin. Yes. Then we go into, go back here again. We prepare the gospel of peace. Okay. Look at this. Preparation of the gospel, let therefore cast off the works of darkness and let's put on the armor of light. We need to do that, the gospel of peace. We're going to need to have peace with God. So how do we have peace with God? We got to be saved. Yeah. So to have the armor of God, you have to be saved. If you're not saved, you can't have God's armor. Yeah. So when we're dealing with spiritual warfare, and when people call me up about spiritual warfare, one of the first things I always say is that person saved? First question. If he's not saved, he's got to be saved before we can go on. Yes. Otherwise, he's in the enemy's camp. How can you fight against the enemy if you're already in his camp? You're one of his. So, then above all, taking the shield of faith. Yes, faith in God's word. Do you believe God's word is true? I was at camp one day, this is a number of years ago, and one of the campers there, these counselors were just having problems with him. He was thinking very humanistically, and he was a very bright kid, and these counselors couldn't do anything with him. So about 10 o'clock at night, they came over into my building, and I was one of the counselors there, and they said, can you talk to this guy? We just can't make him see this way. He just can't do anything with him. So I went over there, and I start talking to him. First thing I asked them, do you believe in God? He said, yes. The second thing I asked him, do you believe the Bible is 100% true with no mistakes? You know what he said? Bible's full of mistakes. All kinds of mistakes. So one thing, he did not have faith in God's word to be true. So I start talking to him, asking questions, and I basically found out that he really didn't believe in God, if it was really true or not. So, but he was very steeped into evolution. And so I talked from 10 o'clock to 2 o'clock in the morning, just standing across his bunk bed. He didn't realize it, but I was playing with his brain. And so he believed in evolution. So I start talking about evolution and creation. He did not realize it, but as I'm talking about evolution, talking about all the scientific problems with evolution, I was moving evolution out, and I was sliding creation in. He didn't realize it. And then about 2 o'clock in the morning, I start talking about Christian principles. And you know what he said? Oh, that makes so much sense. Christian principles make no sense on an evolutionary foundation. They make no sense whatever. But once I had to get that foundation of creation there before he could see Christian principles. And he said, oh, it makes so much sense. Interesting. So what you need to do with the fighting with the shield of faith is you have to have faith that God's word is true. That's a defensive. And that fights against the quench of the fiery darts, because Satan is going to want to put darts. He's going to shoot darts at people, say, oh, God's word is not true. God's word is not true. Evolution is true. Evolution is true. And many kids go off to college, and by the time they get these darts, they lost their shield, and pretty soon they reject God's word because they have fallen for the tactics of Satan. Are you with me? Yes. Yeah. And take the helmet of salvation. You got to believe that you're saved. You have to have confidence that you are saved. Because a lot of people say, oh, today I'm saved, tomorrow I'm not. How unstable is that? And what they're doing is, I've got to do this work to be saved. If I don't do this, then maybe I'm not saved. No, it's not in works, it's believe in Jesus Christ. So we have to have this knowledge, which is the helmet. Where's the helmet? To know that you're saved. Not to have doubts, not to be wishy-washy. And then again, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the sword, word of God, which is, this is an offensive weapon. Yes. All the other ones are basically mostly defense, but the word of God is offensive. We need to know God's word. We need to memorize God's word. We need to know what God's word means. Because when you go into spiritual battle, our offensive weapon is the sword, the word of God. Yes, especially when you leave this country, when you go into other countries, you will actually be in the spiritual battle. You'll probably face some of that. I mean, face to face with the demonic realm. And I've been there. Face to face with the demonic realm. They're alive and well, and they want to deceive you. So our sword, to fight against them, you have to know the word of God. And then we go on. Praying always. That's another offensive weapon. Continually pray. Pray for the saints, because we are in a spiritual battle. Yes. So on. So basically, that's our weapons here. Know that you're saved. Know that how to use the word of God, and pray throughout the day. Yes. But once people start the word of God to be true, they start losing their armor. Isn't that interesting? That's exactly what happened to the woman. She rejected God's word to be true. She actually, before Satan, she was naked. She had no weapons at all, no defense, when she rejected God's word to be true. Yes. So, nor let any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. This word spoil up there is basically a military term. It's like when my army goes into your country, I defeat your army, and I take you and all your possessions captive into my country. Basically, that is what Paul is writing to the Colossians here. He says, beware lest any man spoil you through what? How are they going to take you captive? Through philosophy, isn't that here? Through vain deceit, where's that? Here. After the traditions of men, it's going to be here. And also the rudiments of the world. And not after Christ. Here. So they want to affect, they want to control your thinking process. That's what Satan wants to do. If he can get you to reject the truth, you will follow him. You believe lies. Yes. And again, spoil, that's taken captive. Yes, and I'm not going to go into, basically, when you look at this word, spoil, it means to be captive, a slave. You become a slave. You become my slave. Yes, to lead away from the truth and subject to one's sway. That's what Paul is talking about here. We go on a little bit deeper into it. It's the weapons and valuables stripped off from an enemy. So basically, I take all of your armor, all of your weapons, everything. You are bare naked before me. That's what Paul is warning Timothy, or the Colossians. Beware, don't let anybody take all of your weapons and armor, or you'll be taken spoil. You will be their slave. Yes. When the woman believes the lies of the serpent, she is stripped of her weapon. What's her weapon? Yes. She, again, Satan, and is taken captive and becomes Satan's slave. Did you know that? The woman becomes his slave. She does his will. She is no longer free. She thinks she's free, but is she really free? She is not. She doesn't realize she's actually Satan's slave. And she's going to pay for it. Because of what happened, what he did, she did to Adam, and he to the free tree, and they all die. We're still living with it today. Yes. Either you're a servant of Christ or you're a slave of Satan. There's your choice. That's the only two choices. With Satan, you have no freedom. I've talked to witches down in Mexico. When they get deep into witchcraft, they are no longer their own. They are the demonics. Yes, I got some interesting stories about that. They are no longer free. They are totally slaves, and they do the demonic will. Yes. Yeah. Submit yourself, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. What's the key? Submit to God and resist. Yes. Yeah. Submit is not a dirty word. It's not a negative word. Submit is a positive word. Jesus Christ submits to God the Father's will, and he is exalted. Yes. The resist means stand against. Stand against the tricks of the Satan, the demonic realm. Flee, sometimes we need to flee. There's a time to resist, and there's a time to flee. Yes. And actually, Satan, if you resist him, submit to God, he will flee from you. Yes. No. The woman did not submit to God and Adam's authority, did she? No. She did not resist the serpent, thus she was vulnerable to the serpent's deception. She doesn't resist. She doesn't submit. She falls. No. People do the same thing today. They rebel against God, those who have authority, and they rebel against those who have authority over us. People do not resist the devil. And so they fall for his lies. We see the same thing happening today, all the time. Then they wonder why so many bad things happen to them. Well, it's no wonder. The thief comes what? Steal, kill, and destroy. They said, why do we have all these bad things happening to us in the world? Well, they submitted to Satan's will. Nazi Germany. When sin increases, what happens to suffering? Sin increases, suffering increases. When sin decreases, guess what happens to suffering? Decrease. People wonder, why is all many bad things happening in the world? Well, look at the sin level and the demonic level. Yeah. Okay, there we go. Can you push that button there once, please? It's not coming here. Oh, there we go. Okay, Timothy, in meekness instructing those that oppose themselves. Do you know people oppose themselves? Unbelievers are in opposition to themselves because they're really not doing the right thing. They're not doing what's really good for them. They think they are, but they're not. Pre-adventure, God will pre-adventure, will give them repentance to the knowledge of the truth, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. Can Satan take people captive at his will? Not a problem. What is? How do they take him captive? Because they reject the truth. If they acknowledge the truth, they may recover themselves from the snare of the devil. Oh, I find that interesting. Yeah. Okay, can you turn to the next one, please? There we go. The correct knowledge of the truth and acting on it brings freedom from Satan's traps and deceptions. Did you know that? Interesting. Rejecting the truth goes into snares. Rejecting the truth of Scripture, reject literal Genesis, reject the young earth, reject the Bible, God of the Bible, easily taken captive and fall into the snare of the devil and to his bondage. So, to protect yourself from the snare of the devil is knowing the truth. Yes. John 8:32, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. God's word is true, and Christ is the truth. If you reject that, there's bondage, and you're taken captive. We see that all the time. Yes. The battle is over the mind. Satan wants to control your mind and thus your actions, and that's exactly what happened in the garden. Yes. Okay, can you hit the next slide here? This one's not, we got, there we go. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your, it's always over the mind, isn't it? Always. How do you transform your mind? Basically, the renewing of your mind is getting into the Word of God. Yes. It is a battle of the mind. Our mind and actions need to be under the guidance of God and His Word. You're going to follow somebody. Satan and demons or God, one of the two. You make the choice. Holding fast the faithful word as has been taught, that he may be able to, by sound doctrine, both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. Sound doctrine. Do we need to know sound doctrine? People don't want to talk about doctrine today, do they? It's all feelings, feelings. Well, that's how Satan works. He works in the feelings and emotions of people. Doctrine is where it is at. Teaching sound doctrine. Our focus needs to be on sound doctrine of God's word and not on the lies of the world or our emotions and heart. We see that. Yeah. No. Oh. Satan does not want us to understand God's word as God wrote it. He doesn't mind you reading the word. Just don't understand it the way God wrote it. You know, the Mormons use the same Bible that I use. But how they read it and how I read it, two different things. Yeah. Yeah, earnestly contend for the faith. Are we in battle? You better believe we're in a spiritual battle. We need to contend for the faith. Yeah, we're in a battle. Huh. Now, we're in a spiritual battle, though. We got two camps, humanistic camp and Christianity. There's basically only two groups. There's only, I hate to use religion for Christianity, because Christianity is not a religion. It's a relationship with the creator of the universe. That's what Christianity is. But there's only two religions in the world. There's Christianity, and all these other ones are just a mixture of the same thing. That's all it is. There's only two. What camp are you in? Well, what's happening over here with Christianity? Well, that camp knows if you destroy creation, what happens to Christianity? It will fall. All of Scripture is built on Genesis, and all of Genesis is built on Genesis 1:1, in the beginning God. Yes, that's the foundation, creation. What's happening in the church? Oh, we're attacking these symptoms. Yes, so the foundations be destroyed. What can the righteous do? I'm going to go back here one. Right. We got all these things up here, abortion, racism, pornography. These are just symptoms of the rejection of God's word to be true. That's all they are. A lot of churches are attacking the symptoms. Well, if we just attack the symptoms, don't attack the foundation, they'll just blow up some more balloons. We got the problem with cloning. I do a program on cloning. I mean, we haven't seen anything about wickedness yet until we look at cloning. You know they're making humans, cloning humans, they're not totally human. What are they making? Interesting. Yeah. What's also happening in the church? Well, some are just shooting, wasting their ammo on the color of the carpet and whatever. And did you know most churches are actually destroying the very foundation that the Bible and Christianity is based on, and that's Genesis? Yes. Interesting. Now, if the foundation is to be destroyed, what could the righteous do? If the foundation of Genesis is destroyed, what can we do? Because directly and indirectly, all of our doctrine go back to where? Genesis. Yeah. Well, what do we need to be doing? Well, first thing, we need to be attacking that foundation. So that religion or structure will start to collapse. We need to have answers to their questions. If we don't have answers to their questions, they'll go someplace else to get answers, even though they're a lie. We see that quite often. Many people leave the church because the church doesn't have the answers to our questions. Phil Donahue's show, I don't know if you're familiar with Phil Donahue. Donahue kind of dates the speaker here. But he had a number of Satanists on his show. And these Satanists came from Bible-believing homes. And Phil asked them, why did you become a Satanist if you came from Bible-believing homes? The reason why is because the church didn't have the answers. So they went someplace to get answers, even though they're lies. Interesting. We also need to be attacking those symptoms. We also need to be doing one more thing. These people here, these are not the enemy. The people are not the enemy. These people need to be saved. I used to be in that humanistic camp. That's where I used to be. Somebody in that camp witnessed to me, and I came out of that camp and came into that camp. These people need to hear the gospel message so they get saved. God loves all those people. He wants them all to be saved. They're not the enemy. Yeah. Question is, what castle are you in? Take your pick. We're in one or the other. There's no other castles. There's only two castles. God's castle or Satan's castle. Those are the two. You make a choice. Any questions there? We're going to take a look at man's response to sin. Okay, man's response. And the eyes of them both were open, and they knew they were naked. Yes, now, nakedness now becomes evil or sin, which when their eyes were open, they knew they were naked. This is now spiritual death. This is spiritual separation from God. That relationship now has been broken. Yes. And the eyes of them both were open, and they knew they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Okay. They knew they were naked. They knew their sin. And what did the man and the woman try to do to their nakedness or sin? Try to cover it. The natural response to sinners to sin is to try to cover up their own sin by doing good works. This is the first good works religion here. Good works for salvation. Man is always trying to cover up his own sin. Isn't that what man does? Oh, if I get baptized, I'll be saved. If I do all these good works. I was there. I was taught if you did these Christian rituals or you did these good works, you'll get saved. I was taught when I died, they had this big scale up by heaven. Have you heard about this big scale up by heaven? If they pile your bad works on one side of the scale, they pile your good works on the other side of the scale. And depends which side is heavier, depends where you went. That's what I was taught. So guess what I was doing? I was piling up my good works. Because how many good works does it take to get saved, and how many bad works does it take to get lost? I discovered later, one bad work, one sin, guess where I'm going? Hell. So I was trying to pile up my good works. I wasn't drinking, I wasn't smoking, I wasn't taking drugs when I got saved. I didn't kill anybody. I was a good person. Haven't you heard that? I'm a good person. I'll go to you won't. There's no good people in heaven. Only perfect people. Only sinless people. Only holy people make it to heaven. That's it. Isn't that interesting? Natural tendency is good works. You've been to funerals. Oh, this guy was baptized. He was a member in the church. He was this good man. He's going to be in heaven. No, none of those will save him. That's man's response to sin, but that's not salvation. Yes. Job is speaking to his friends. Job 31, 33. If I cover my transgressions as Adam. What did Adam do? Try to cover his own transgressions. By hiding my iniquity in my... He was trying to cover up his own sin. But it doesn't work. Yeah. Adam, his eating of the forbidden fruit and covering sin with plants, again, when we look at this, is a true historical event. Job talks about it. He knew about Adam and the woman and the sin and everything, and they try to cover up their own. This is all true historical event. And so basically, when we take a look at man's response to sin, what does he always want to do? Cover his own sin. Now we're going to take a look at Adam's sin brings fear, guilt, shame, and condemnation into the world. That's not the way it's supposed to be. Yes, not at all. And gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. When he ate, again, we talked about this already. When he ate the fruit, their eyes were open, and they knew they were naked. Okay, now, we take a look at this. Something interesting is happening. This is spiritual death. We talked about that. And their thinking has been altered or changed by sin. We look at Genesis 2:25. And they were both naked, the man and the woman, and they were not ashamed. Which is interesting. In Genesis chapter 2, they knew they were naked. They knew they were naked, but they were not what? They were not ashamed. Because they had this perfect thinking process. Once they ate of the fruit, then they knew they were, well, they already knew they were naked. So that means this nakedness takes on a whole new meaning. When they sinned, they were ashamed and felt guilt and fear of condemnation because of their sin. Yeah. We take a look at Genesis 3, 10, and 11. And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid. Because I was naked. Do you know they were not literally naked? They had just clothed themselves with fig leaves, were they not? When they sinned, didn't they close them with fig leaves? So that means he was literally, thank you, he was literally not naked. So it's not the nakedness he was afraid of. Oh, can you go back one there, please? There we go, thank you. They clothed themselves with plants. I hid myself. They were afraid of judgment, and they're ashamed of their sin. Because when you take a look at the law said, on the day that Adam eats of the tree, he will surely die. This word surely die means to have one executed. That word surely die in the law does not mean spiritual death. It doesn't mean spiritual death. It means physical death. The blood is going to flow. Does Adam understand what's going to happen when he ate of that fruit? Totally. He knows he's a dead man. So he is in fear of condemnation and judgment. He's ashamed of what he has done. Now, you parents can understand this very well. As long as there's noise in the house and everything's going right with kids, everything's just kind of hunky-dory. Then when something gets really quiet, that's when I get concerned. Okay, because I know something's, right? Am I on, you know what happened? God comes in the garden and everything's quiet. Adam, where are you? Woo-hoo. He knows where he's at. Isn't that interesting? Does human nature change? It doesn't change at all. Yes. So, if you're in sin, there should be shame and guilt. Did you know that? Shame and guilt is spiritual pain warning us something is wrong. A lot of people want to do away with shame and guilt, but there's a purpose for shame and guilt. If people are living in shame and guilt, that means there is a problem, is there not? There's a sin problem. It's just like when you put your hand over a fire, is pain good? Yes, if you don't have that pain, you will burn your hand. So that pain there is telling you there's danger. That's the same way with shame and guilt. If somebody's living in sin, that should tell them something is wrong and there needs to be something done about it. Are you with me here? And the thing that needs to be done about it is It's our relationship with God. Because what does God do? He takes away shame and guilt and condemnation. God does not want people to live in shame and guilt. Did you know that? That was never a plan. Adam and the woman, when they were in their sinless state, there was no shame, there was no guilt, and there was no fear of condemnation. Perfect relationship with God. Shame and guilt brought spiritual pain, knowing that we've got a problem here. There's danger. Something needs to be done about it. Yes. You go to the next one. Thank you. Yes. And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked and hid myself. Again, why was he afraid? Well, and why did he hide himself? Yeah, that one can go. Because he was naked, but he was not literally naked, was he? He was already fully clothed. So it has to be his shame and guilt and fear of condemnation, what we have here. Adam and the woman had already clothed themselves, so they weren't literally naked. Again, it's that shame and guilt. If you continue on, thank you. Yes, fear of condemnation because of his sin. He knew he's a dead man. For the day he eats, he's going to surely die. Some people, yeah, keep going perfectly. Yes, there we go. Some people try to cover their fear and shame and guilt by good works. Do they not? Oh, if I do all these good works, then God won't send me to hell. Or they use drugs, alcohol. Some will even deny God exists so they can deal with the shame and guilt. See, they don't deal with it in the way they're supposed to deal with it. Shame and guilt should bring us to God so we can deal with it, and he'll take it away. Because he doesn't want us to live in shame and guilt. He doesn't. Yes. So what is the remedy for shame and guilt and so on? God will provide a remedy. Again, he doesn't want us to live in that. If you go to the next slide, please. Thank you. Yeah. Now, next one thing. Yeah, thank you. God is not the author of fear, is he? God does not want us to live in fear. Christians should not have grounds to be afraid if we are in his will. Fear brings bitterness, anger, shame, guilt, disappointment, panic, bondage, and so on. You know, you talk to people, the church is scared today. Why should the church be scared? Is not Jesus Christ greater than that of the world? Is he not greater than Satan and all the demonic realm? That tells us something. If the church is scared, that means, are we walking in God's will? Yeah. Okay. I was afraid. Go to the next one, please. Thank you. Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord. What does sin do to a person's action? God comes in the garden. What do these sinners do? They flee from his presence. That's what the Adam and the woman do. They hear the word of God and they flee. So when you're witnessing to a sinner, if he doesn't want to listen to you, it's no big surprise, because his natural tendency is to do what? Flee from God's word. He doesn't want to listen to you. And when we won't get into Genesis chapter 4, but sometimes they'll even kill you. That's what Cain did to Abel. He didn't want to hear the gospel message. Abel was a man of righteousness. He was preaching the truth. Cain didn't want to listen to it, so he killed him. Yeah. Sin had an affected their view of who God is, didn't it? Because now they have a different view of who God is. And they fled. God is a God that wants a loving relationship. So does sin affect your thinking process? Yeah, it does. Does it affect your view of God? Sin affects your view of God. That's right. You cannot, well, we'll go back to this, you cannot hide from the presence of God, can you? So Adam was foolish to hide from God, didn't he? Yes, because how can you hide from God who is everywhere? So it's changing. Sin has changed his view of who God is. He should have just stood there out in the open and said, God, I'm sorry, I disobeyed you. But he doesn't. He hides and covers his sin. And his thinking of God has now been warped. Okay. Yeah. Any questions there? Is it making some sense? Don't people do the same thing today? There's nothing new. People do the same thing today as they did with Adam and Eve in the garden. Now we're going to take a look at God's response to sin. Yes. I'm a little bit distracted there because the thing wasn't clicking. But basically, man's response to sin is do good works. Try to cover up sin his way. Also, shame and guilt comes in the world. Adam brings that in. But shame and guilt is just pain, no giving us warning that our relation, there's a problem with our relationship with God. With a good relationship with God, we should not have fear of condemnation, guilt, or shame. So a person living in shame and guilt and fear of condemnation, there is a relationship problem with God. Is that making sense? Yes. So shame and guilt and fear of condemnation is good because it's a warning that we need to get our life right with God. So God's response to sin. Before we get into starting this, are there any questions so far? Yes. Okay, well, have you ever experienced falling off a cliff? You never experienced that, right? If you fell off the cliff, would that be a good thing? No. You know when you hit the bottom, it's a bad thing, right? Now, Adam, he didn't have to develop a language. God imprinted or made a language in his brain. So he knew exactly what would happen when he would eat of the fruit. He knew what it meant to die. Because he knew, he had a perfect language, perfect meaning of the language. Yes. Okay? I don't have to experience, I don't have to even see someone fall off a cliff to know it's a bad thing. Okay, when I hit the bottom, it's going to be hurt, or I'm going to die. So he understands that. Even though he has an experience, we know a lot of things that we don't even have to experience it, but we know it's not good. Yeah. Does that make sense? Yes. And people ask that question all the time. Most questions that people ask, other people ask it too. So, alrighty. Any other questions? Okay, we're going to take a look at God's response to sin. Now, the law says, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. Again, that word die means, when you look at it, it means to be killed, to be put to death. Basically, it means to have one executed. Sin equals physical death. Also equals spiritual death. Okay. But in this law, the law meant physical. Basically, surely die means to die, die. That's what it is. It's repeating. Die, you will die, die. Yes. Now, every time, going back here, every time surely die is used, it always means physical death. Doesn't mean spiritual death. Even though they did die spiritually right away when their eyes were open, they knew they were naked. Yes. Now, the wages of sin is death. This, in this case, both physical and spiritual. So the spiritual law is if you sin, you will die. Sin equals death. Very important law because it also deals with our salvation. What does sin and death have to do with our salvation? We will talk about that. Hopefully we'll talk about that. Hopefully get enough time to talk about that. So now suffering and death enters into the world. God did not bring death and suffering into the world. Man brought death and suffering into the world. A lot of people say, oh, if there's a loving God, why is there so much death and suffering into the world? Well, God didn't bring it in. Who brought it in? Man did. See, man gave us a brain, did he not? Does he expect us to use it? Yes, he does. Are there consequences to our actions? Yes, there is. What we are seeing today is a consequences to our actions. God is not this God that he's going, oh, don't do this, don't do this. No. He wants a loving relationship with people. He does. He's not going to treat us like puppets. He didn't make puppets. He didn't make robots. Yes. So, now that's why we have all this death and suffering. And as sin increases, as the demonic realm increases, demonic activity increases, what happens to suffering? It increases. Look at Nazi Germany. There was an increase of demonic, basically, influence taking place in Nazi Germany. Hitler was probably a satanic high priest. He was deep in the occult. So here we have an increase of demonic realm and activity. We also have an increase of sin. And what happens to suffering? It's no surprise. Decreased demonic activity, decreased sin. What's going to happen to suffering? It's going to decrease. Oh. For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that maketh the atonement for the soul. So basically, death and bloodshed is a blessing, but it's atonement. It's a cover. That's what atonement means, to cover. So bloodshed, the law demands death and bloodshed as a penalty for sin, but also demands death and bloodshed as a atonement for sin. We're going to talk about that. So death is a curse, and death and bloodshed is also a blessing. Yeah. God came up with a brilliant plan. I mean, it was brilliant to bring death and suffering into the world when Adam sinned, because he's going to save us out of the world through death and suffering. Yes. Death and blood are an atonement for sin. Also, the penalty for sin. But we are all as an unclean thing, and all our righteousness are as filthy rags. So when Adam and Eve clothed themselves with fig leaves, did it do anything for their salvation? Not a thing. Adam knew that. That's why he said, I hid myself because I was naked. He knew the fig leaves didn't take away sin. He knew that. That's why he hid himself. Because they're still all what? Filthy rags. All of our good works are filthy rags. Yes. Only blood can cover sin. Plants don't. Yes. So, and the woman tried to cover their sin their way, but it's only filthy rags. Don't people do the same thing today? Oh, yeah. We're no different than Adam and the woman. We do the same thing. Yeah, no. So, sin equals death. Sin actually equals eternity in the lake of fire. This is for eternity. This is everlasting punishment. Some false religions will teach, oh, you'll just be annihilated. No. Everybody lives forever. Everybody does. Both believers and unbelievers. Everybody lives forever. Did you know that? But there are two places where people are going to live. One is in the smoking section. The other one's in the non-smoking section. Where are you spend eternity? That's the bottom line. Yes, this is forever. If you get thrown in a lake of fire. See, God is holy and cannot tolerate our sin. God is just and cannot overlook our sin because he is the just judge and he has to judge according to the law. Is that right? If you sin, you must what? Die and go to hell. That's what the law demands. God is also righteous and perfect. That's his attributes. But only holy, righteous, perfect, sinless people will live forever in heaven. Did you know that? That's the only way you're going to get to heaven. You have to be sinless. You have to be holy. And the reason why is because God is also holy, righteous, perfect, sinless. So if you're going to live with him, you've got to have this. Did you know in the beginning, Adam was made holy, righteous, perfect, and sinless? That's how he was created. That is our true nature right there. That's the way it's supposed to be. When somebody says, oh, I made a mistake, I'm only human, that's not the way it's supposed to be. That's our fallen state. God's going to undo everything. Are you with me here? This is the only way you enter into heaven. Well, we take a look at James 2:10. For whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point is guilty of all. How many laws do you have to disobey to go to hell? One. We're born going to hell because in Adam we all die. So that means, is this bad news? It is really bad news. Yes. Now, people say, oh, God won't send people to hell. God doesn't send anyone to hell. People choose to go there. Hell was never made for man. Did you know that? Only Satan and his angels is never made for man. Man was never supposed to go to hell. That means people must choose to go to hell. The question is, whose heaven is it? Who sets the rules for entering into his kingdom? Is it our heaven? No, he sets the rules. We don't set the rules. We don't get into heaven our way. We get into heaven his way. Because there's only one way we can make it into heaven. Because we have to be holy, sinless, and righteous to get into heaven. Yeah, so, only those who have fulfilled the law can live forever in heaven. Did you know that? You have to fulfill the law. Whoa. That's bad news. Now, God is also loving, gracious, and merciful. Which means, God doesn't want the man and the woman to go to hell, does he? He doesn't want the man and the woman to die, does he? Because his love and mercy demands that they live and have a close relationship with him. That's what he wants. But his just nature has to carry this out. He has to carry out the law. So which means God has provided a way for us to be close to him, which satisfies his holy just nature. He's got to satisfy this nature, and he's got to satisfy that nature all at the same time. Are you grasping this? How's he going to do it? He's got a brilliant plan. Brilliant plan. Almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. Yes, well, go back to here. The law requires what? Their death and bloodshed for their sins. Isn't that what the law requires? And the just judge has to carry out the law, correct? Yes. The question is, did they die, physically die, on the day that they ate of the fruit? No, they didn't die. Adam and the woman did not die on the day they sinned, but they were supposed to. That's what the law demanded. Which means God's love demanded a sinless substitute sacrifice to die in their place. There has to be death and bloodshed for the covering of sin. Was there death and bloodshed on the day that Adam and the woman sinned? Yeah. They were clothed with coats of skins. And when you skin an animal, guess what you shed? Blood. I like to hunt. So when I'm up there hunting, if my aim is good, when I pull that, and just before I pull that trigger, I cringe just a little bit because I know what that bullet is going to do to that animal. And it's not a pretty sight. But I like to eat elk, so I pull the trigger. Okay? See, I have rheumatoid arthritis. That's where all these bumps on my hands are. So there's one thing, so I control my rheumatoid arthritis with diet and supplements. I don't take chemicals. And I feel real good if I'm a good boy. And there's one thing, meat, I have problems if I eat too much domestic animals, chicken, turkey, cattle and beef. If I eat too much meat, I will start stiffening up. There's one thing I can eat and I don't have much problem with. That is elk. So I'd like to get my elk. That's my staple diet when it comes to meat, is elk and seafood is also good. But when I pull that trigger, I know what's going to happen to that elk. It's not a pretty sight. It's going to die. Shed a lot of blood. So then when I get up there, you know what I have to do? Pull up my knife, time to gut him, skin him, and I've got blood over me. I mean, it's not pretty. So God came into the garden and killed at least one or two, I don't know how many, innocent animals because there has to be bloodshed. Plants don't take away sin, do they? They don't have blood. So God actually came in, killed, I believe, sheep. And why I believe he killed sheep? Because Abel sacrificed sheep. And why did Abel sacrifice sheep? He's modeling after the first sacrifice that was done in the garden by God. So these innocent animals who did no sin, they didn't sin. They took on the sin in the man and the woman, and they died so the man and the woman could be clothed in coats of skin, which is a blood atonement, so the law can be appeased for that day. Are you with me? Interesting. Yes. Now, we also have, there was curses too. There was the thorns, sweat, and eventually they are going to die because the blood of goats and animals and sheep do not take away sin, do they? It's just a blood atonement. It's just a piece of the law for that day, which means they're eventually going to die. Physical death. So these three curses have to be paid in the future. Well, we're looking to the past. They're looking to the future. Okay, now, because of sin, there will be cancer, there will be diseases, there's going to be illness, there's going to be genetic defects, there's going to be mutations. Things are just going to get bad. As time goes on, things are going to continue to get worse. All of creation is groaning and moaning until the return of Christ. Did you know that? He's groaning because God's going to come back and set it straight again. But right now, we're in this fallen world. Yes. It is not God's will for people to have these problems. Did you know that? That's not God's will. He never wanted sin, death, and disease to come into his world because he wanted everything perfect. I find that interesting. It is a consequence of Adam and our sin. That's why we're in the mess we're in and Satan's deception. Yes. His plan is to put it all right again. That's his plan. Yes, but God will be with us through life's difficulties, will he not? Yes. When we look at John 9, and his disciples ask him, saying, Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? What does Jesus say? And answer them, neither hath this man sinned nor his parents, but that the works of God should be made manifested in him. He didn't sin that he was blind. His parents didn't sin that he was blind. Basically, it was consequences of Adam's sin. But they were blaming this, oh, he's blind. That means he must have did something bad. No. When it came down to it, his blindness was for God's glory. Isn't that interesting? His blindness glorified God because God healed him and he saw again. So when we take a look at this, our lives should glorify God, should they not? In whatever situation we are in, should we glorify God in that situation? Even we're on the deathbed, should we not glorify God? Yeah. That's some of the best places to glorify God, because people wonder, why do you think that way? You're about ready to die. Why do you think that way? Again, according to Scripture, death is an enemy, but death is just the beginning for eternal life, is it not? Didn't Paul say, to die is gain, to live is Christ? What would Paul sooner do? Oh, he sooner die to be face and face with Christ. But as long as he's alive, he's going to glorify God in his body. Yeah. So, Jesus, God, is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. He wants all people to be saved. He doesn't want anyone to go to hell. Yes. Yeah. We look at that and we continue on. God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. This is God's focus right there. He wants to undo the things that Adam has done. This is what he wants. God doesn't take joy in the suffering that's going on. He wants to go back to this. He's going to undo the sufferings that Adam and our sin. Yeah. So we look at this. Hebrews 10:4, for it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sins. Adam and the woman knew that the blood of these animals did not take away sin. It only appeased the law for that day. So that way they're not executed. Something had to die. Genesis 3:15, and I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise its heel. He tells the man and the woman that there is going to be a seed of the woman. This seed of the woman is going to destroy the usurper, Satan, but something bad is going to happen to the seed of the woman. But it's not a fatal blow. He dies on the cross, but does Jesus Christ stay dead? No, he rises again. But they know that there's going to be a man. There's going to be a man that has no sin. And this man who has no sin, just like those lambs, will die for the sins of mankind. Yes. Isn't he so cute? He's great. All right. All righty. So the lambs being shedding their blood in the garden is just a foreshadowing of Jesus Christ coming to die on the cross. That's all it is. Adam and the woman were looking forward to Christ coming to die on the cross. We look back. Yes. 2 Corinthians. For he hath made him, that's God the Father, hath made God the Son to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made righteousness of God in him. Our righteousness in Jesus Christ. Yes. This is what I call the principle of substitution. Somebody is taking our place, taking our sin, and dying in our place, so that our relationship can be renewed with God. Because God does not want us to live in shame, guilt, and condemnation, right? That's not what he wants. He wants us to be renewed with him. And the next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, behold the Lamb of God, which take away the sins of the world. The Lamb of God goes all the way back to Genesis chapter 3. Did you know that? It doesn't start with Moses. The Lamb of God is in Genesis 3. But with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish, without spot. He was sinless. Yes, just like in the garden, those sheep were sinless. Now, Hebrews 10:1. For the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the comers they're unto perfect. So all that, all those sacrifices the Jews were doing never made them perfect. Basically what it was is a temporary covering. It was focusing on Christ. See, the law is a shadow of God's righteous, holy nature. That's what the law is about. The animal sacrifices was a shadow of Christ's sacrifice, which is God's salvation. These are all shadows of Christ and his righteousness and his death and suffering. That's all they pointed to. That's, which are the shadow of things to come, but the body is of the Christ. The thing is, focus on Christ. A lot of people still are focusing on the shadows, the Mosaic law and all this kind of stuff. I mean, they're missing it. This, all these laws and all these rituals were always just to point to Christ. They're pointed to Christ, point to Christ. Don't focus on the shadows, focus on Christ. Romans 5:14, who Adam is the figure of him, Jesus, which is to come. See, Adam is a figure of him to come. First Adam blows it, so the last Adam has to undo it. Because we got this first and last Adam going back and forth, back and forth. Again, the first Adam, first man, Adam, was made a living soul. The last Adam was made a quickening spirit. We're going to talk more about the first and last Adam. See, the last Adam must undo the damage the first Adam caused. Well, we'll talk more about that. Now, for since by man, that's Adam, came death, by man, Jesus Christ, came also the resurrection of the dead. Only one man can bring sin into the world, and only one man can do what? Bring salvation to the world. A woman can't bring salvation to the world. An angel can't bring salvation to the world. Only one man. That's why it's so important to understand that that law, I'm going to talk more about this, the law was only for Adam. Only he could bring death into the world. Jesus Christ also was given a law to die on the cross for our sins. And that law was only given to Jesus Christ. So only Jesus Christ can save us from our sin. There's nothing we can do to save us from our sins because the law was never given to us. See how important it is to get the first law right with Adam so you don't mess up with the last law with Jesus Christ? But if you mess up with the first law, a lot of people put, oh, we can save ourselves. No. God never gave us a law to save us. There's nothing we can do to save us except for one thing, trust in Jesus Christ. That is it. That's why it's so important to get the first and last Adam correct. I came from a church that rejected the first Adam, and they added to the last Adam. Interesting. Yes. First Adam disobeyed the law. The last Adam actually fulfilled the law. We're going to be talking more about that. Yes. Now, there's only one way salvation can come into the world. Only one way. There's only one way sin can come into the world, and that is through Adam eating the tree. That's the only way sin can come into the world. Satan can't bring sin into the world. The woman can't bring sin into the world. Only the man can do that. There's only one way salvation can come into the world. Wherein is love. Not that we love God, but that he, that's God the Father, loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. That word sent means to order one to go to a place appointed. So God the Father orders God the Son to a place appointed, which is to come to this earth. Okay, any questions there? So the Son was given a commandment. Only Jesus Christ was given this commandment to save us when we look at it. Now, Philippians, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death on the cross. Adam was given a commandment. If you eat of the tree, you will do what? Die. Jesus Christ was given a commandment. That commandment was to die on a tree. Save us from our sin. Only he was given that commandment. Nobody else was given that commandment. Yes. Yeah. Jesus Christ, again, fulfilled the law. We're going to talk more about the law as we continue on. Only Adam was given the commandment not to eat of the tree. Only Jesus was given the commandment to die on the tree for our sins. It is impossible for sinners to save themselves. Did you know that? You know why it's impossible for us to save ourselves? We were never given a commandment. Did God give us a commandment to save us ourselves from our sins? No. That means there's no way we can save ourselves. So we have just eliminated good works. Any church that teaches good works, that you can do something to save you from your sins, is a false church. It's a false gospel. Actually, that doctrine comes directly from Satan. Remember what Satan did in the garden? He wanted the woman to get involved with the law, right? That you could bring sin into the world. No. You know what Satan does to the church? Oh, you have to do something to save yourself. It's not Christ alone. Are you with me here?
Do you see the deception? Perfect deception.
You add anything to faith, it is no longer grace. You can't be saved. If you add anything to faith, it is no longer salvation, because now it's works. Yes. So the Word became flesh, and he became the innocent sacrifice, just like in the garden. That lamb there. Yes. Now, when he was on the cross, he said, "It is finished." Yeah. He fulfilled the law. He obeyed the commandments. For as by one man's disobedience, many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made. It's last, first and last Adam, back and forth, back and forth. Had nothing to do with the woman, nothing to do with the church. Yes. Again, through one man's disobedience, we all become sinners. Through one man's obedience, we can also be made righteous. Yes. To only one man, I hit this quite often because there's a lot of false teaching in the world about how we get saved. Only through Christ can we be saved. Yes. Now, just as a woman could not bring sin into the world by her good works, so we also cannot be saved by our good. Is this making sense? I hope so. Yes. Now we just eliminated false doctrine right there. False gospels are gone. If you get Genesis right. That's why it's so important to get Genesis right, because if you don't get Genesis right, you mess up in your theology in the New Testament, which vast amount of the most of the churches have already done. Yeah, enter ye at the straight gate. This is Jesus. For wide is a gate, and broad is a way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. Isn't there a lot of people leading to destruction? Because it's very narrow to be saved, because the narrow gate is who? Who's the gate? Jesus Christ, that's it. Everybody else wants to put, oh, be baptized. Do good works, do this. No, Jesus is a narrow gate, just through him, that's it. Yes. Any church or religion which teaches you can be saved by good works or rituals is a false religion. That's what the Bible teaches. This is not being very politically correct, is it? My topics are not very politically correct. I get in a lot of trouble with my topics. Yes, but Jesus Christ got on the cross because he was not politically correct. Yes. Satan deceives the woman to think the first commandment is also for her instead of Adam only. That's the eat of the tree. Satan deceives the false church to believe the last commandment, salvation, is also for her, which becomes a false church instead of last Adam only. Jesus, are you grasping that? Commandment is only for Jesus to save us, ourselves. Satan's deception is to make people believe faith in Christ alone is not enough to save us. We must also partake in our salvation by adding good works and rituals. That's all Satan's deception. That's the same deception that Satan used in the garden on the woman. Nothing different. No. The seed of the woman shall bruise thy head. That's Satan's head, Lucifer. And thou shalt bruise his heel. That means something bad's going to happen to Christ. The promised seed will come to destroy Satan and his power. We see that. Because through death, he, that's Christ, might destroy him that had the power of death. That is the devil. Who has the power of death? Satan does. Interesting. Yeah. Death. The miserable state of the wicked dead in hell, you know, and so on. Spiritual death. You know, who keeps people's minds blinded from hearing the gospel and understanding the gospel? Satan does. If people don't hear the gospel and understand it, where are they going to end up in? Eternal separation from God, that's death. Satan keeps people's minds blinded so they don't understand the gospel. He does have the power of death. Yeah, Satan blinds their minds, which in this case is spiritual death. And the last enemy that shall be destroyed is God will destroy death. And that's coming. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone where the beast and the false prophets are and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. I mean, this is forever and ever, people. You don't want to go there. Yeah. The Revelation 20:10 is fulfilled in Genesis 3:15. When Satan is thrown into the lake of fire, that means his head is bruised. That is a fatal blow. He will not come out of the lake of fire. So Revelation 20:10 is the fulfillment of Genesis 3:15. Is that making sense? I can't wait till that day comes. Boy. Yes. Adam and the woman will eventually die because the blood of animals does not take away sins. They are temporary, it's a temporary covering. Only the blood of a sinless man can take away sins. Yes. Now we have thorn, sweat, and they're eventually going to die. These curses have to be paid. Well, have they been paid? Yes. Did Jesus Christ wear thorns? Yes. Did he sweat? Yeah, he sweat blood. Did he die? He died on the cross. These curses have been paid by Jesus Christ. Yes. One day he's going to take away all this. I can't wait. Again, by one man, Adam, all die. By one man, well, all human DNA except for Jesus comes from Adam. Did you know that? All of our DNA comes from Adam. That means we were all in Adam when he sinned. Our DNA was. That means in Adam all, we're born dead. That means we have to be born again. That's why we need to be, Jesus Christ says, you have to be born. We're born dead. So now we have to be born alive in Christ. We're born in Satan's kingdom. We've got to be reborn in God's kingdom. And that only happens through Christ. People say, oh, what does he mean by born again? Well, we're born dead. Yes. We're all born sinners. Wages of sin is death. Yeah. Now, man, through Christ, we all can be alive. Jesus doesn't give us salvation. Did you know? It's salvation is not like a piece of paper. He is our salvation. Our salvation is in him. By man, in Christ, we all shall be made. We got to be in Christ. And that only comes when we trust him as Savior. Yes. Our salvation is not in us or a church, but in Christ alone. Yes. Either we die and are condemned for our sins, or we trust Jesus Christ died for our sins so we can have eternal life. Hey, it's your choice. You pick it. Now, for by grace are ye saved through faith and not of yourself. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So again, saying a prayer will not save us. Walking the aisle will not save us. Baptism or some Christian ritual will not save us. Going to church or attending some special denomination will not save us. Good works will not save us. A lot of people put their faith in all that stuff. Only thing man can do to be saved is have faith in Jesus Christ. Yes. Now, the shed blood of Jesus is the only sacrifice God the Father will accept for the forgiveness of sins. Did you know that? That's the only sacrifice he will. If we try to do some other kind of sacrifice, he won't accept that. Only one is accepted, and that is trusting Jesus Christ. That's the only sacrifice God the Father accept. So, salvation is a free gift, but it must be received by faith. In Christ, there is no condemnation, shame, fear, and guilt. Jesus bore our shame, condemnation on the cross, did he not? He endured the cross, despising the shame, because sin brings in shame and guilt and condemnation. God did not want that, so he put all our sin on Christ, and so Christ died on the cross, bearing our shame, so we don't have to live in shame and condemnation. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in. Yeah. Isn't that good? That's good news. So if people are living in fear of condemnation, guilt, and sin, they need to get right with God. Shame and guilt and fear of condemnation is a good thing because it points us to Christ. When we trust in Christ, God takes on he's taking the shame and guilt. Yes. Therefore, any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Yeah, old things have passed away. We're a new creature in Christ. Yes. What's God's goal? This is God's goal. I am come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. That is God's goal. The thief comes and steals, kills, and destroys. That's why we have all these bad things in the world. What's Christ want to do? This is what Christ wants to do. He wants to set everything right. This is his goal. So, we take a look at this. Everyone will stand before Jesus Christ. Do you know everyone stands before Jesus Christ? Unbelievers will stand before Jesus Christ and they'll see Jesus as their judge. Believers will stand before Jesus Christ and they'll see Jesus Christ as their Savior. So the question is, when you stand before Christ, is he judge or Savior? That's the bottom line. Yes. Now, let's take a break here. The importance of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Why is the resurrection so important? It's in Genesis chapter 3. The resurrection is very important. And we'll talk about that when we come back. Are there any questions? No questions?
denied them.